Good evening and welcome to Introduction to Advanced Placement for Parents. My name is Edward Biedermann. I'm the Executive Director of the Advanced Placement Program. My team and I help schools, districts, and state expand access to AP and ensure high-quality programs for students in their communities. I'm delighted to be here with you this evening and facilitate this presentation for parents. What we'll do with our time is we'll first introduce the panelists for you, provide an overview of the Advanced Placement Program, take a quick tour of exploreap.org, an online portal for students and parents. Then we'll hear from the panelists. We'll learn what should parents know about AP, what is it like in an AP classroom, what is the value of AP in higher education, and then we'll have an opportunity for those of you listening in to ask questions, and we'll have the panelists respond to those questions that you submit. To start, I'd like to introduce Dr. Gail Kaplan. She's a professor in the Department of Mathematics at Towson University. She specializes in development and dissemination of active approaches to learning math. Dr. Kaplan has authored articles on the use of projects in secondary school classrooms and has taught AP Calculus for 10 years. She is the winner of the 2001 Presidential Award for Excellence in Mathematics and Science Teaching. Maryland Senate honored her efforts to make a difference in delivery of mathematical techniques in the classroom. Welcome, Dr. Kaplan.
Thank you.
We also have Kelly Stromberg. She's an AP teacher at North Central High School in Spokane, Washington. And Kelly has taught six AP courses throughout her time as a teacher. She's taught English language and composition, English literature and composition, world history, European history, AP seminar, AP research, and has over 20 years of experience teaching AP. Welcome, Kelly, to the panel.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
We'll start with a quick overview of AP for those of you who are new. AP has been around since 1955. The AP program has been delivering excellence in education to students since then. AP lets students pursue college-level studies while in high school with the opportunity to earn college credit, advanced placement, or both. Taking AP shows college admissions officers that students have sought the most challenging courses available to them. Students who score a 3 or higher on AP exams are more likely to graduate college on time and have the potential to save time and money through placement and credit granting policies. Research shows that students who score below a 3 on an AP exam are also more likely to graduate college on time. So why AP? What AP can do for your students? Recent research shows that AP students perform well in college courses related to their AP subjects. AP students, and particularly AP STEM students, are more likely to major in their AP subject or related discipline. AP students take more, not less, coursework in college related to their AP subject. AP students are more likely to graduate in 4 years, and AP provides opportunities for underrepresented students to succeed. So how is AP developed and AP taught? AP offers 38 courses across 7 subject areas. Each course is developed by a committee of higher education faculty and expert AP teachers who ensure that the course reflects college-level expectations. The committees define the scope and goals of the AP course, clearly indicating what students should know and be able to do upon completion of the course. The committees work with the Educational Testing Service to develop exam questions. They also write and review the course descriptions for each subject. Courses are taught by high school teachers using AP course descriptions. Teachers determine how best to present the content. AP exams are based on the content in the course descriptions, and all students take a standardized exam for each course. In English, we have AP English Language and Composition and AP English Literature. 5 AP courses are available in mathematics: AP Calculus AB, AP Calculus BC, AP Computer Science A, AP Computer Science Principles, and AP Statistics, noting that AP Computer Science Principles will launch for the first time this fall. In science, we have 7 courses: AP Biology, AP Chemistry, AP Environmental Science, AP Physics 1 and Physics 2, AP Physics C Electricity and Magnetism, AP Physics C Mechanics. The difference here is in AP Physics 1 and 2, those are algebra-based physics courses, and AP Physics C courses are calculus-based physics courses. In history and social sciences, we have 9 courses. AP Comparative Government and Politics, AP European History, AP Macro and Microeconomics, AP Psychology, AP United States Government and Politics, AP United States History, and AP World History. In the arts, we have five AP courses, AP Art History, AP Music Theory, AP Studio Art 2D Design, 3D Design, and Drawing. In World Languages and Cultures, we have eight courses, AP Chinese Language and Culture, AP French Language and Culture, AP German Language and Culture, AP Italian Language and Culture, AP Japanese Language and Culture, AP Latin, AP Spanish Language and Culture, and AP Spanish Literature and Culture. And finally, we have two capstone courses, AP Seminar and AP Research. For parents and students who are interested in learning more about AP, you can explore AP online at exploreap.org. Here, you will have a navigation bar at the top with five options. You can explore AP, you can look at AP courses, taking the exam, AP scores, and credit and placement policies. We'll spend a few moments going through each of them individually. In the Explore AP tab, students and parents can learn what it takes to take AP courses, what the AP experience will be like, the rewards of AP, how AP can help map to your future, how to enroll in AP, and a special section for parents. In the second tab for AP courses in the navigation bar, you can explore connections to college majors and careers, conversation starters and other related AP courses, recommended preparation, higher education credit policies, and in these courses you can dive in to learn the curriculum frameworks and sample exam questions and previous free response questions. On the Taking the Exam tab, you can learn about specifically about the exams, the AP calendar, when each exam will happen in May, exam policies, and best practices for preparing for the exam. The AP Scores tab, this is an opportunity for students to view their scores, send their scores to colleges, get answers to score-related questions, and learn about AP awards that are offered to students who do well in AP exams. And the final tab is the Credit and Placement tab. Here, students will learn how to earn credit through their AP coursework. They can search credit policies that universities they're choosing, and they'll find out how AP and college work together. But now I'm excited to turn over to our panelists and ask them a series of questions to help lead a discussion on what AP means both in high school and in college. We'll start first in the classroom, an AP classroom. What is it like in an AP classroom? So Kelly, can you tell us, what can a student expect in an AP class?
Sure, absolutely. I guess first and foremost, students can expect that they're going to end up with a challenging college-level course. Although teachers, of course, have the freedom to deliver AP courses in the way that makes the most sense for their own student populations, and so AP courses will vary from classroom to classroom and state to state. All AP courses certainly prepare students with the knowledge and the thinking skills that they're going to need in order to be successful on the AP exam. I think that oftentimes students sort of, they have an idea already of what they think that they will find in an AP class. And sometimes when students are trying to decide which courses to take and whether or not to add an AP course to their schedule, they tell me that, you know, they hear the rumors that the course is too hard, or that there are hours and hours of homework, or that, you know, they won't be able to fit it into their schedule with their other classes or their other activities. They worry about the super smart kids who are in the course. And many students sometimes worry about whether they're ready for that challenge or not. And I have my own two boys who have just finished with high school and gone on to college, and we had these same conversations at my house about what to expect and what they thought versus really what they should expect in an AP classroom. And so when students choose AP, here's what they get. They get a teacher who's been selected to teach the course based on their subject matter expertise. Administrators recognize the demands of an AP course, and they select staff based on people who have expertise and excitement about teaching that higher level subject matter to the students. there is external accountability through the AP course audit, which, you know, helps to provide consistent delivery of the course to students, regardless of where they are. And they have a teacher who has access to rich support and training materials that are available when the College Board has approved the course for a school. So they end up with really solid quality, consistent instruction. And when students choose AP, they also get a course that has been carefully and thoughtfully developed with a very consistent research-based approach. And Edward Biedermann spoke to that already, so I won't go on about that. But it's very intentionally and thoughtfully done. And that means that it doesn't matter whether students in Virginia or Oregon taking an AP physics class, they're working towards the same content outcomes based on that same curricular framework. A student gets a course that's designed to mirror the same content that's found in a similar survey course, the same content on a college campus. And that means that the course is developed to provide a rich, challenging content to a student, which will get them ready for that next level of challenge when they get to the college campus. And they, of course, as students in this course, will have the same support materials available to them from the College Board's student support sites. And I guess the last major thing I would say about what students should expect when they choose to take an AP course is that they're going to end up in a classroom where the other students in the classroom share that same consistent goal, mastery of the content and success in the goals of the course and that end goal of success on the exam, which potentially could mean college credit for them. They end up with a culture in that classroom that values the content that they're getting. So I guess that's what a student should expect when they enroll in an AP classroom.
Thank you. Kelly, what strategies do you impart to your students to help them be successful in AP? What advice would you give them?
I think really that kind of boils down to five big suggestions or tips that I would offer that I offer students that we talk about explicitly in my classes. The first thing would be it's important to know where you're going. So keep a specific calendar of what the year will look like, both short and long term things that are coming up, so that they can use that to keep big picture goals, and they can keep that in mind as we're moving through the school year. They often, almost always, will get a syllabus from their teacher. That's part of the AP course expectation, and they can use that to create this calendar. We do this in my classroom, but I tell students they should be doing this for all of their AP classes, is creating a calendar for themselves. The second major tip I give students about how to be successful in AP is that they should consistently, regardless of the subject matter, they should take those big ideas and those big concepts, and they should break those into smaller pieces or smaller chunks of information. We know that that's a more effective way for them to learn and retain information, and so that's a strategy that we talk about and use quite a bit. Third big tip for them to be successful is so important to be disciplined about time management in the classroom and outside of the classroom with their workloads. Fourth big piece is really critical for them to stay organized. I teach explicitly, but they also have access to, in many ways, a variety of methods or approaches to keep themselves organized, and they need to find the method that works best for them. It doesn't work for me necessarily to dictate how they should do that, and I really talk to them about finding how they best organize themselves. You know, for example, we use what are called SMART goals, which is about setting goals that are measurable and time sensitive. But there are all kinds of approaches, pen and paper, digital, all kinds of things. And the last thing that I tell them that's critically important is that they need to stay informed. They need to take frequent tours of the Explorer AP site, and after they've gone through that useful information, they should find other sites that will help them succeed. And if their teacher does not explicitly provide them with those, they can seek many things out on their own. They're digital natives, and so I tell them to harness those skills. They should check Khan Academy, who's recently partnered with the College Board. Other content-specific sites based on whether they're talking about chemistry or literature. And then another piece of being informed is maybe accessing their school's librarian professional, however that exists at their school. But there's usually someone that's another great resource for that. So those are my kind of five major tips for students.
And thinking about the tips that you've given your students, what advice do you have for parents of those students? What do you tell parents to help them empower their kids to be successful in AP courses? What can parents do to really help?
That's such a great question. And now having experimented on my own children and my own parenthood, I've got even more insights into this. So this is, when I have the parents in for our AP night, this is kind of what we talk about, and I have six basic points. The first is attend your school's AP open house or AP night or the equivalent, if it's possible. Go to whatever open house you may have at your school, because this is how you will get a really strong awareness and understanding of the course demands, the major deadlines and assessments, grading policies, all those things that may throughout the year come up and add to some of the complexities of the course. So my first big tip is see if it's possible for you to go to the school's event or open house. You definitely do that. Another major point that was important for me as a parent and that I tell the parents of my students is it's really important to recognize the different demands that AP classes may have than other courses may have. It may be time, because the amount of work a student is doing. It may be a cognitive demand. Often these are college-level courses that are demanding a kind of thinking that students are not as familiar with, and they need a little support with that. And perhaps emotionally, as students are going through this new intellectual demand. Third big point is have comfortable dialogues and interactions with the course instructor, because all of us want the same thing for the student. We want what's in the student's best interest, and we want the student to be successful. And we're all on the same team, so the better that conversation is, the better off the student is. The fourth thing I would say, making sure to encourage your child or your student to use the various available resources, online, at school, their teacher, their peers, a variety of the resources that they've had pointed out to them. Remind them that there are resources out there to support what they're doing. Fifth, provide support for regular work on the coursework, rather than that. Sometimes teenagers, they have so many things that are going on that they need a little support managing. And so rather than to get behind, get overwhelmed, panic, regular work on the course so that it doesn't snowball. And finally, be realistic about student schedules and work with your school to safeguard the well-being of the student and to select the number of AP courses that are the right fit for your particular child or student. And it may be two, and it may be seven. So you just gauge that carefully. And so those are my six points. And then it's just important to remember the AP websites, the Explore AP and the AP Central are really strong resources to remember. So those are kind of my parent reminders.
Thank you very much. Kelly, we often hear kids who may be reluctant to take an AP course talk about AP may not be for them, or AP is for particular types of students. Sometimes we hear parents say that as well. Can you tell us a little bit about the types of students who have taken your AP class and perhaps the different types of students that have taken your class and been successful in it?
Absolutely. So this certainly is going to vary with schools and districts and nationally or internationally, but so I can speak to my classroom and I can speak a little bit to what I've seen as I've worked with people across the country. But my AP classroom is populated with a very wide variety of students. The commonality is that they want to be there, and they've specifically and intentionally chosen to take the course that they're in. I have students in my room who have taken, by the time they're seniors, 12 or more AP courses and consistently received qualifying scores of threes and fours and fives on all of them. And I have students who've never taken an AP course, and we're all together in the same course. What separates the students in an AP classroom from other students is it's not about whether they took all honors courses in middle school, and it's not about some other IQ points or test scores or other. It's really about whether they have the desire to take a challenging course where they know that there's a strongly designed course and that their support can place for them to be successful. So AP students are students who know they're taking a challenging course, but also know that they're all going to be held to the same standards and that they value the same things. And AP students are students that the ones that are in my class have had a variety of educational experiences, but the thing that brings them together is that they're all interested in learning rather than killing time until the bell rings. And so that common factor is that commitment to learning. And while their goals vary, I have students who are taking AP classes because they want, you know, an advantage in admissions for competitive schools. They may want an advantage in competition for scholarships. Some of them are, you know, honestly hoping that they end up with qualifying scores and with college credits at the end of that. Some want to be in more advanced classes once they get on college campuses. But the type of AP student that I have is a student who takes a challenge on. And I have had students successful who are taking their first AP class as a junior or senior, or those who started taking AP classes the minute they were able to. So does that get at a little bit of what you were asking?
It really does. And let's think about students who have never taken an AP class before. What can they do to be successful?
That's also a great question, because we really at the school where I teach try to encourage as many students as possible to try to take on the challenge of one of these challenging college level rich courses. Every student is at some point a student who's never taken an AP class, and the advice is pretty consistent. For a student who's considering their first AP class, regardless of where that is in their high school career, the biggest point is that I try to remember that I try to remind them that they are part of a team and they are not in it alone, that their school and the teacher and parents want them to be successful. So they need to make sure that they do not get to the point they're overwhelmed. They talk to other students, to their teacher, and to their parents or the adults in charge of them early on if they're feeling a little uncomfortable. That they should set up study groups. And I know that's not always what students' first go-to is, but it's so incredibly helpful. And based on anecdotally, my own children, my students, and research all says that this is an incredibly effective way for students to find support and success in challenging classes. Those students need to find support online. There are so many websites that are really helpful, starting with Explore AP and moving on to other potentially content-specific sites, and making sure they check in with their teacher regularly about how they're feeling and how they're doing, and being honest about communicating concerns if it's their first course, and alerting the teacher of that right out of the gate. And then same thing, communicating with the parents about or guardians about workloads and concerns. And back to that time management thing, the piece that's really critical for students doing this for the first time may be that they haven't had to manage their own time as independently before, and that's a really good skill that they need to continue to work on and also seek help on if they're needing to immerse themselves in that. But again, the first point I made is the same as the last point I will make, which is There is support in place, not only on College Board end, but in their school and with their instructor that will help scaffold them up so that they can be successful in their endeavor.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that perspective and sharing those thoughts with us. Let's turn our focus to higher education. And Professor Kaplan, can you help talk to us about the value of AP in higher education? Specifically, you know, what are the benefits from the higher education, from your perspective, from the higher education perspective, taking AP classes while in high school?
Well, as a parent of three children, Rachel, Ariel, and Josh, who all took advanced placement courses, I truly believe that the level of rigor in those AP classes significantly contributed to their success in college. Students are often better prepared because they've actually had a course in high school that is run like a college-level course. When students go to college, there's often an adjustment period. And so if they've taken an AP course, they don't have to adjust to that rigor because they've already experienced it. And regardless of the discipline, AP courses promote higher-level critical thinking skills, and that just makes a huge difference in college classrooms. Students who have taken courses that require these skills are the most successful. I mean, a well-run AP course forces students to do this before getting to college. And I guess lastly with that, I would say that the journey through higher education and beyond is really never ending. And an AP course just provides the ideal opportunity to take the first step in a successful manner because the high school teachers are going to be so supporting to them.
Okay. You know, Professor Kaplan, in addition to being a math professor, you are also an AP calculus teacher. What would you tell a parent or high school student who hasn't taken AP why they should take AP?
Well, I can tell a little vignette about a student. Her name was Robin. And students often met with me when I taught in the high school AP calculus course. And that was a course that really was a bit daunting to even think about. So Robin came in and she asked me if I thought she should take the class. And I answered truthfully, and I told her that I really, you know, the math classes she had taken with me previously, she had done well, but it just didn't seem as though she really loved mathematics. And so would she want to work that hard in a subject that she didn't seem to love? And her response was that I was correct. But she knew that the kids who were taking that AP Calc course would just be exciting to work with because they were all pushing for the same goals. So I really have three suggestions if your child and you are thinking about AP. And the first is to talk to your child. Find out what academic subjects or careers interest them. Of course, they might not know. I mean, how many of us knew what we wanted to do when we were teenagers? So another thing to do is to talk to the counselors and teachers at your high school to find out what AP courses might work best for your child. And if none of that works, pick an area of strength for your child or a particular teacher who just has inspired your child and sign up for that AP course. Our son Josh went to college with more than a semester of AP credits. But when he was in high school, I spoke to one of his high school teachers for advice about taking an AP course in her discipline. And she said to me that she really didn't think it would be a good match, that particular discipline wasn't one of his strengths at that time. And that was excellent advice as well. So he took other AP courses that he certainly was successful in.
Okay. And how would you best characterize the college students in your math classes who did take AP? How do they stand out or compare or stand up against students who may not have taken AP? What do former AP students get? How would you describe them in your current college classes?
Well, if a student has taken an advanced placement course in calculus, where the content is specified. So in an AP course, they will have gone through particular content, and that's consistent across the country. The student will already realize that their college classes are going to require an in-depth understanding. An in-depth understanding not only how to do computations, but of the theoretical ideas, why those computations are going to work. And that certainly is essential for success. And that translates to other disciplines as well, not just mathematics. Regardless of their performance on the actual AP exam, the students who have taken an AP math course realize the level of mastery that that type of course in college is going to demand. And the sooner students realize what higher ed courses are going to be like, the quicker they're going to be able to reach that level. In mathematics, students really understand that math is not just memorizing formulas and procedures, but understanding why those computations work, how to apply them in real-world situations. And that doesn't always happen in the pre-AP courses. And probably the strongest thing for me is, for many students, college is an adjustment. It's often the first time they're away from home. It can be daunting. And that adjustment period, it just is an easier transition when the students have already had the experience of AP in high school.
Well, thank you very much for sharing your perspective as well and how AP is valued in the higher education space and colleges and universities in your classroom, in your college classroom. I do want to take some time to open it up for questions from the audience. And I'm going to ask my colleague Adele if she can help us come through the questions and ask them to our panelists.
We have the questions that many of you submitted in the corner, and so we appreciate your submissions. We're going to do our best to answer as many as possible, but we won't be able to get to all of them. Following the presentation, we will be posting the recording of the presentation deck, as well as answers to more questions at collegeboard.org/parents. But for now, we're going to answer a few. So, Kelly, I'm going to ask this first question to you. Are there any preconditions for enrollment in AP? How do students get enrolled?
That's a great question. And so I will give the general answer, which is I certainly cannot speak for all schools. There are different policies in place at different schools. However, I can tell you, in general, the College Board suggestion to school administrators is that the prerequisites for an AP course should be that the prior coursework has set a student up to be successful in the class. For example, you would not want to have a student taking the AP Calculus BC course who had not progressed beyond second year algebra. They wouldn't be quite ready for that. That having been said, there is not a College Board policy that they are required to have any specific course in place before they can take an AP class. So it's determined generally by either the school or the different departments. In our school, we have, and this is becoming more common, we have an open enrollment policy. So students who are wanting to choose the challenge of an AP course are welcome to do so, and unless, as I said with the AP Calculus example, unless they're missing a course that's really critical for them to progress, they're allowed to take the challenge. So Edward might be able also to speak to some of the wider experiences that he's had with different districts as he's done outreach. So that's our policy and procedure. That's how we do that, and how I think there's quite a bit of commonality there among a number of districts. But what else would you like to add to that?
Sure. Districts make local policies that make most sense for students in their communities. They use a variety. Districts use a variety of indicators to find students who are ready for AP. Some of them use AP Potential. Some of them use prior coursework. Some of them use GPAs. What we find is that teachers in previous courses really know their kids best, and college counselors or school counselors can really help students navigate which courses kind of are right for them. So we encourage parents and students to really talk to college counselors and their teachers about the AP courses that are offered in their schools and what it would take and what is required to be in those courses.
Great. The next question, Gail, is for you. When do AP exams occur and how are they graded?
Well, the AP exams are for about a week, and it's a week in May normally, right? Or is it a two-week span or a one-week span?
Two-week exam window.
Okay. And what was the second part of that question? How is it graded?
And how are they graded?
Okay. It's actually an amazing process. I've been grading the AP Calc exam for about 15 years. And so right now we go to Kansas City, and close to 1,000 mathematics university professors and high school teachers come. We get into trained on particular problems, and then we read through those problems. The consistency on the exams is really utterly amazing. So part of the exam, the multiple choice part, is done by a machine. But half of the exam, we call it the free response, where students are actually writing out solutions, are actually graded and read by human beings. So that's the process.
Great. Yeah, I can attest. From hearing from many teachers who've participated in AP readings, that it is truly amazing to get together and see all of the great work of the students and grade them all together.
It is. It's very exciting.
Edward, the next question is for you. How many AP courses would you suggest a junior and maybe also a senior would take at one time?
So there is no one right answer, one-size-fits-all answer for every student. We hope that all students take at least one AP course while they're in high school. But really, it's a personal decision based on conversations the students have with their parents and with teachers. You know, we believe those students who show the motivation, have the family support and teacher support to take an AP course should enroll. And so we really recommend that families speak to their school college counselor to figure out what is the best path for their child, taking into consideration other coursework the student is enrolled in, other extracurricular activities, and understanding that AP offers an admissions benefit in the college application process. So balancing all of those variables for individual kids is kind of a no one right answer exists. At a minimum, though, we encourage all students to take at least one AP course while they're in high school.
Great. Kelly, is it possible for students to take an AP test without enrolling in the course?
Well, yes, technically it is. As a student that has gone to the AP website and has looked over what the course demands and expectations are and either prepares himself or feels that they are prepared for the exam can certainly sit for the exam. They have to sign up for it and find an accredited place that is offering the exam, and often that might be another school nearby so that they have signed up properly on the website and they can speak to the school about that. But there's quite a bit of flexibility built in so that students who are in maybe a smaller community or a more rural setting, they aren't limited by what their school may or may not be able to offer. So it's not necessarily recommended, but there is the facility for them to be able to do that.
Got it. And I think that somewhat answers another question that others had about what if their child wants to take an AP course that isn't offered at their school. Is there, can they work independently and take the test? But I
so,
think you.
So yes, I think that gets to some of the same pieces. Absolutely.
Great. Gail, this question is for you. How is the course content across the country standardized? So how are these course descriptions developed?
Well, there's a committee that decides on what the content is, and periodically it's changed. For instance, for AP Calculus, there have been some modifications that will go into effect for the next exam, which is in May of 2017. But the committee worked on that for several years, and then it was presented to consultants who helped to train AP Calc teachers, and then it gets distributed on the website, et cetera. So the content stays pretty stable, but there certainly are some small fluctuations. And so I think the College Board does a good job of making sure those are done in a reasonable way.
Great. Edward, can you tell us, can students outside the United States take AP courses?
Yes, they can. We have a number of students. We have many students, international students, who take AP courses. AP exams are offered at sites all across the world. And so a student can log on or call AP, log on to our website or call AP services to find out schools or testing centers where they are internationally. Register for an AP exam. If students happen to be lucky enough to be in a school that offers the AP course, it is very likely that school will also be offering the AP exam. But the College Board has resources available to help students figure out where AP exams are administered across the world.
And I should also add that over 600 universities worldwide accept AP exam scores as part of their admission process. So it's great for students applying to schools in the U.S., but also for students around the world as well. Okay, so we have time for a couple more questions. Edward, someone asked about the new AP Computer Science course. Because it's so new, will students have access to test material to practice with? Because I know for lots of other courses, they use past AP tests to help them practice.
Yes, there are materials that are available to students. We would encourage students to go to the exploreap.org website. And they can go to the second tab in the top navigation bar for AP courses. There will be a drop-down menu. All the 38 courses that we offer are listed. They go to the AP Computer Science Principles, click on it, and then that link will have all of the resources that are available to students for them to help prepare for the exam.
All right. Kelly, can you tell us about the AP Capstone program?
Well, yes, I can probably go on and on and on and on about it, but I will try to be measured in my response. So the AP Capstone course is a relatively new AP offering. It's a pair of courses it's a program. It's the AP Capstone program, and it's comprised of two different courses: the AP Seminar course, which comes first, and the AP Research course, which comes second. And the big picture and the quick snapshot at the same time is that these courses are designed to get at higher level thinking skills and critical thinking skills. And the students in these courses are taught how to look at an issue and how to determine what are all the elements of a particular issue, and then how to figure out what all of the perspectives are that are involved in exploring such an issue. And then they're taught research skills and what constitutes college-level research and how to start to evaluate the quality of sources and the quality of the evidence provided in those sources, and then how to put all of that together to construct a solid evidence-based argument. And so in the about whatever issue that they may be exploring, the courses are taught in a number of schools now. There were up to, I think we're closing in on 500 schools now for the upcoming year that are teaching these courses, and more are coming on board all the time. And students, the goal is to teach them these skills that will transfer into other AP classrooms and onto college so that they understand the parameters of undergraduate research. Because when they go from that junior year course to the senior year course, they're moving into a research course where they are selecting a topic of interest and significance, and they conduct a school year long research course on that that culminates in a 5,000 word formal research paper and is accompanied with a presentation of their research findings and a defense of those. And the courses are just amazing. The students in those courses have created some amazing research. From one student in the AP research course this year, she researched the most appropriate and best approach to modeling a prosthetic hand for her, for someone for a refugee in a refugee camp, and printed it with a 3D printer. Some just amazing research has come out of these things. And one of the amazing things about the courses is that much of what research the students do as they're learning these skills is driven by their own interests. Different schools organize the courses differently as far as themes, and that varies school to school. But in general, much of the research that's done is driven by student interest. So that may seem like too long an answer, but they're pretty amazing courses, so it's difficult to keep them brief. If that didn't get at it, please let me know, and I'll fill in other blanks.
No, that's great. I know people who participate in the AP Capstone program really love it. So thank you, Kelly.
Adele, I'd like to jump in just a moment to remind folks that AP Capstone is available to a limited number of schools as it begins in its launch years. So schools are eligible to apply to offer the AP Capstone program in their schools. And we have about 650 schools that are currently participating in the AP Capstone program. It is the only, within AP Capstone, AP Seminar, and AP Research course, those are the only two courses for which schools must apply before they can offer it. And that's only in the launch years of those courses, because it is a diploma granting program.
Great. Okay, so two more questions. Edward, where can people find more information about which colleges give credit for which AP exam scores?
That's a terrific question, one we get all the time. So we've made an easy-to-use portal on exploreap.org. So if you were to go exploreap.org, at the top navigation bar, the fifth tab, which is the last tab, Credit and Policies, you click on it. And what students will be able to do is they can search for universities. They click in the university that they are most interested in attending or have questions about, and it will immediately populate with the university's credit and placement policies for the AP courses that it recognizes. And it will link you directly to the university's relevant web pages to describe more information about those credit and placement policies. I should note that that information is updated annually in a survey that is given to all the colleges and universities in the country. And it is also updated immediately if the university informs us that their policy has changed throughout the year.
One other question that we received from a few of you is about which grade level is the right time to take AP. Edward, I think you somewhat got to this when you talked about how many AP courses students should take, but can you talk a little bit about which year you should consider taking AP courses?
Sure. Also a terrific question, and one we hear from parents and students all the time. So AP are college-level courses. So the vast majority of AP courses are offered to 11th and 12th graders. There are some AP courses, some schools that offer AP courses to 10th graders, and even fewer schools that offer some AP courses to 9th graders, because the idea is that these are college-level courses, the equivalent of college-level courses, and so students It would be extremely challenging to be successful in AP courses at such younger grades. So there's no right answer here. Most AP students take AP courses in their 11th and 12th grade year. There are a couple of courses. So, for instance, AP Human Geography is an AP course that is offered, that is widely offered in 9th grade, but not all schools do that. AP World History is a course that is widely offered in 10th grade, but not all high schools do that. So you're likely to see in your school's course syllabus, course guide, AP courses in 11th and 12th grade.
Great. And then last question, Kelly, for you. Are students able to retake the AP exam for their course?
So the answer to that is yes. Students certainly can sit for an exam a second time. And of course, the exams are different every year, so they certainly aren't sitting for the same exam, just the same course content exam. The exams change. But they choose to which schools to send their scores. And so if they took an AP exam and didn't get a score that they were as happy with and they took it again, they could resend their score to their schools of choice that next year, and the school would get that that new score and be able to use that for admissions and for potentially for credit issues as well.
But they would need to wait a full year before testing again?
I'm sorry, absolutely. So we have the testing window. We have the 2 weeks, full weeks of May is the testing window, and you can go to the College Board website and see the exam schedule for the next 2 years, in fact, so you'll know which days they are. But the exam is offered at one time on one day, and there is an alternate seating of exams that is available in case students have some kind of an issue or a conflict with the exam, and that's determined at their school. Whether their conflict constitutes a need to take an alternate sitting. Otherwise, there is the one offering, and if they, once they get their scores or for whatever reason want to take it again, they need to wait for the following school year's exam sitting.
Great. Well, I think that's about all the time we have left for questions. As a reminder, we are going to post an FAQ on collegeboard.org/parents. So, Edward, I'll kick it back to you.
Great. Thank you very much. And thank you to my co-presenters, Kelly and Gail and Professor Kaplan. Thank you to everyone who's tuned in this evening. We'll share this recording of the presentation and the presentation PowerPoint at collegeboard.org/parents. And I've posted here resources for reference for students and parents. They can go to exploreap.org. For international students and parents, the link here is available. And then more information about parent webinars will be available at collegeboard.org/parents. Again, thank you everyone for tuning in, and we hope that you will consider AP in the future.